church where we've gathered on this, the third Sunday of Pentecost, to continue our worship of Christ, to learn more about what he's called us to do in the world around us, and know how we can encourage one another with the gospel. Before we get started, I do want to call your attention to the announcements that are printed in the worship guide, and please take note of the schedules of this next week. The ladies' Bible study will be resuming in August, and so ladies that have been attending that know that you can talk with Miss Barbara, and she'll let you know exactly when that's going to happen, but there'll be a pause on the ladies' Bible study until August. There'll also be a pause on our youth Bible study until August as well, with all of the summer schedules and vacations and people going here and there. I think it would probably be best for us to just take a pause, and then we'll resume that in August. The men's Bible study, however, will continue on, but there will be a pause this week because I will be taking Braden Drew and a second Drew. Yes, there are two Drews connected with our church. The second Drew will be going to church camp this next week. And so I do want to ask that you would to lift up all of our campers. I think there's 125, 130 students who will be coming, going up to Fort Payne, Alabama this week from across our presbytery. And they will be worshiping Jesus and learning more about Jesus and fellowshipping together in Jesus' name. I'll be leading senior high youth Bible studies. And so just pray for the week, pray for our safety, pray for the time that we'll be spending together, and that God will be glorified during this next week. Also, today we did have a session meeting scheduled, but after consulting with Ms. Dolores, who is our, I should take a moment here to just express my appreciation to Dolores, as well as...
Brian and I were just talking out here in the hall, so I was a little late walking in, and he's going to take a second or third look at our stuff.
So just a nice little snippet of what a session meeting sounds like, right? I did want to just take a moment to have everyone know, if we don't already appreciate Dolores more, let me give us one more thing to appreciate Ms. Dolores more for. She is our stated clerk of the session, which means she comes to all the session meetings, and she takes all the notes, and she presents the other aspect of what she does, which is being our church treasurer. She shares with us the financial realities of the church, and she does great work doing that. And then also as our administration, our administrator here at the church, she's the one that mans that phone. And anytime we get phone calls from business, as well as crazies, and yes, we can get phone calls from crazies in our community. And she goes through all that, and so I just want to take a moment to say thank you, Ms. Dolores, for all that you do for Homewood Church, and know that you are appreciated. We were going to have a session meeting today, but we are due to quorum, which means we don't have all of our session members here today. We're going to postpone that meeting. We'll transact any business that we have over the course of the next week
I was trying to grab you while you were talking about Dolores.
Yes.
She's an exceptional Bible scholar.
Absolutely. And that's exactly right, Ms. Barbara. As Dolores also serves as a very, very faithful, and as Ms. Barbara said, exceptional Bible scholar in our Sunday school program. That is another thing that we are very appreciative for. But for our elders, know that if there's anything that is pressing, we're going to be in touch over the course of the next week, and we'll transact any business that we need to do and make any decisions that we need to do via email or phone. So we will not have a session meeting this afternoon at 1:30, contrary to what our announcement says here in the worship guide. The last thing I want to say is, as we look around here, we see that there's quite a few folks that are not here that are usually here with us. And we also know that we continue to do our part as the hospital survey team, making sure that healthcare in Birmingham is up to snuff. And so we do video all of our worship services. And so I want to speak directly to all of you who are at home recovering from surgeries or sickness, those who are traveling. We do have some that are traveling around the world. We do want to let you know that we miss you. We miss seeing you. And we hope that you get well soon, as well as get home safely, because we look forward to those days when we can all be back together as a church body. With that said, I'm going to invite all of the young people, and that means everyone in this room, because I think if you're breathing, you're young. So all young people, we're going to have our children's message right now. So hey, Miss Lawson, how are you doing? Good. Hey, Braden, Drew, and Ava, how are y'all? Okay. Yeah, we're okay. Have y'all ever wondered about what it's like to be part of the body? Have y'all ever thought about your organs? Like, what do your organs think about? Have you ever thought about that, Lawson? Like, our brain does all the thinking, right? But do you think our heart thinks? Our heart just seems to know what it's doing, right? It just knows. It beats. Our lungs, they just kind of work. Our lungs seem to know what they are doing, right? They breathe. We have that stomach, that the stomach seems to know what to do when we eat. What happens in our stomach, Miss Lawson, when we eat? It digests our food for us. And why does it do that? It's to give us energy, right? It's to give us energy so that we can do. You know, there's that one little organ in all of our bodies that some of us still have, others don't. It's that one little organ called the appendix. Y'all ever think about that poor little fella? I don't even think we know what the appendix does. It's just there, right? It's just there, and the only time we really know that the appendix is there is when? Yeah, when it gets sick, when it gets unhappy. When that appendix gets unhappy and it bursts, though it doesn't really do a whole lot, if that thing bursts, you know that something's not right. If you've ever had appendicitis and had to have your appendix removed, you know what that is. Well, everything about us has a purpose. And at one point in time, some scientists will say that the appendix did something. And maybe we don't really know what it was that it did, but we only really know when it's there because something's not right. Well, every part of us, every part of our body has its function and it does what it does. Our heart beats, our lungs breathe, our stomachs digest, our livers clean us up, and the appendix just lets us know when things aren't good, right? And your tonsils, that's right. That's awesome. Well, I want us to know that Paul tells us that it is very important to be part of the body. And sometimes when we are part of the body of Christ, in 1 Corinthians, Paul tells us that each person of the body has a special role. And he says to us that the eye cannot say to the hand that you're worthless because you don't do what I do. The hand can't look at the eye and says, oh yeah, you may be able to see, but try picking up something. The hand will have to pick it up. You know, the stomach cannot look to the brain and say, hey, brain, you're not as important as I am because I digest food. And the brain says, oh yeah? Well, if I'm not living, then you can't do anything. Well, Paul tells us in the Gospels that each and every one of us have a special part in the role of the church. We all have a place. Our hands, our feet, our legs, our hearts, our lungs, our stomachs, our brains, everything has its special purpose. And so what that means for us is that every one of us, Ms. Lawson, as you get older and as you grow up in the church, and kids, as y'all grow up in the church, you will find your place in the church. Just as we talked about this morning with Miss Dolores and how she's a Sunday school teacher and a stated clerk and an administrator and a financial person here at the church. And I can look around this room and I can see Miss Barbara, who is someone who teaches the ladies' Bible study. And I look at Mr. Tommy here, who's an elder in the church. And Mr. Brian and Mr. Tommy will sometimes come out here, and Miles, they'll come out here and they'll do work around the church. We all need each other. And so as we live our life together in the body of the church, I think it's important to know that whether you're young or whether you're old, you have a spot. You have a special purpose in the church to accomplish tasks. tasks so that we can live. Now, we know that our bodies really have a hard time. If we didn't have a brain, we couldn't live. If we didn't have a stomach, we couldn't live. If we didn't have a heart, we couldn't live. If we didn't have lungs, we couldn't live. And we can even talk to people who maybe don't have a hand or a foot, and they can tell you it's very hard to live if you don't have that part of the body. So I want to encourage you this day, everyone in this room, to know that you have a place and you have a special purpose in the church. And without you, this church can't be alive. And so what we need to do is know and understand that it is important to know what God has called us to do and how we are to go forward in life. Because we don't live only for ourselves, but we live for this place, which is the Homewood Church. And we live for this place so that we can help other people understand and know where true life comes from. And that true life comes from Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Will y'all join me as we pray together? Father God, we do thank you for today. We thank you for all of the many parts of our bodies, Lord, the body of Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you have gifted us with individuals here at the church who can teach and serve and cook good food and pray well and sing well and lead us in those things, Lord God. And we ask you, Lord, that as we continue forward and as we think about who we are as your people and as your body, that, Lord God, that we would know that above all things, that we don't just live to just do certain tasks, but we live to bring glory to your name so that others in the world around us may have hope, that they may have peace, and that they may know that you love them. Lord God, we love you and thank you, and we ask all of this in Jesus' name. I want to invite everyone to stand as we are called to worship this morning. Our call to worship comes from the Gospel of Matthew and from Psalm 130. We're told in the scriptures, the Lord desires mercy, not sacrifice. Jesus calls not the righteous, but sinners. People of God, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. Lord Jesus, make us holy in your truth, so that we may be able to share your glory with the world. Amen. Let us pray. Mighty God, we do thank you for this time that you've given us to come into the doors of your sanctuary, to worship you, and to breathe in life anew. We ask you, Lord God, that you would be with us and guide us through this time together. And help us, Lord, to know that you do love us, that you are with us, and that, Lord God, that you have called us to be part of this place. Lord, we love you and thank you and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We begin worship this morning with the singing of hymn number 8, verses 1, 2, and 4 of Come Thou Almighty King.
Thank you.
Friends, God is light. In God, there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Christ while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as Christ himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. Friends, let us confess our sin this day then, first silently and then together with our prayer of confession. Friends, let us pray. Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now pray together. God of grace, love, and communion, we confess that we have failed to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We ignore your commandments, stray from your way, and follow other gods. Have mercy on us. Forgive our sin and raise us to new life, that we may serve you faithfully and give honor to your holy name. Amen. Holy God, we give you thanks and praise that you have poured out your Spirit upon us through the gift of our baptism, so that we might proclaim your mighty acts in every language of the earth. We give you thanks and praise for Jesus Christ, who through the baptism of his suffering and death poured out his life and love for the world, so that we might be delivered from sin and death and receive the gift of life everlasting. By the power of your Holy Spirit poured out upon us in baptism, fill us with the joy of resurrection, so that we may be a living sign of your new heaven and new earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, believe the gospel. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Let us now affirm our faith this day in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Friends, I want to invite you to listen carefully this morning, for this is God's Word. Paul writes, God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Therefore, remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you are also being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I want to invite you to stand as we now sing hymn number 640, Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Thank you.
Last week we began our sermon series on keeping the main thing the main thing. We talked about the importance of worship and the dimensions of worship. How worship is much more than us just gathering together to sing songs together. But that worship is a way of life. It is us always being aware and knowing and understanding that God has been at work in our lives. He continues to be at work in our lives, and He will be at work in our lives. And so everything that we do in our life is a response. It's a response to that living God who has called, is calling, and will call us into service for Him. When we think about the Christian worship, we think about it in terms of us living obedient. Living obediently as a shining light to the world around us. So that those who, as Paul will talk about, those who are far off might have a beacon where they can then see, hey, I can get back close. I can resume back into fellowship with the living God. Worship is a very important aspect of who we are as the people of God, because when we think about our lives as a response to what the living God is, then it would spur us then into thinking about and understanding what should that response be. Which is what the second part of this sermon series is going to talk about. What is it that our response should be? If we're to keep the main thing, which is us understanding that God has blessed us with all of our life, and that we are to return to Him thanks and praise, and then respond to what God has done to us with obedience, what's that next step of keeping that the main thing? Well, the second step and the second part of that that we have determined and discerned here at Homewood Church is that we are to grow. Now, when we think about growth, we may think about one thing. Just as we may think about worship, we may think about worship being, hey, we're going to get together and we're going to sing songs. And that's one aspect of worship. Growth has a very similar type of kind of schism within it, some sort of thing. When we think about growth in the church, we automatically go and think about numbers. One of the things that when I tell folks that I'm a pastor of a church, nobody asks me what do I preach. Nobody asks me what we're studying. Nobody asks me what my sermon was about the week before. They ask me, how many people go to your church? How many people do you pastor? It's kind of a weird thing. Because as a pastor, I sit and look at it as there is this dimension, this depth to being a pastor and to being a church where we're more than just a place where a lot of people gather. To grow in the faith not only means that we are to grow in number, that's absolutely true. We've been called in the Gospels to go and proclaim the gospel to nations. We're to teach people how to recognize who Jesus is and how to respond to them. In Matthew 28, Jesus gives that great commission and says, go teach and baptize in my name and tell them what I have taught you about life. But what we're supposed to do in that is not just look at that and say, hey, we're growing, that's good. It's not a simple checklist, which hopefully y'all know in my 13 or so years that I've been here at the church, I don't really care much for just checklists. There's a lot of things like perspective. There's a lot of things like intangibles that we need to be looking at. If we're going to keep the main thing, and we're going to think about growth, we have to all think about our individual growth. We can't all stay at the same place our entire lives. Which some of us may think back and look at and say, man, if I could go back to when I was 18 years old and just stay there, that would be great. And I'm looking around and I'm seeing people, no. But imagine that. Imagine if we got to that one age where we were perpetually just that age, and we never got older. That would say things about us that we're just stuck. But growth is one of those things that we should all be looking at, and it is something that we are all participating in each and every day. A lot of times in our day and time, when we think about growth, we think about experience. And within the church, I do believe that there is a wonderful place for us to think about our experiences. And what do those experiences teach us? And then, how do we then respond to those experiences? So you see that there's a connection between worship. If worship is about our response to God, growth is our response to the experiences and the things that we go through, the things that we learn, the things that we hear, the things that we apply into our lives. And as Paul is talking to this group of Christians in Ephesus, we know that he is there speaking to a diverse group of people. Paul is always speaking to a group of diverse individuals. And a lot of times those individuals come from very different places in life. You have Jewish Christians, you have Gentile Christians, which a Jewish Christian is someone who has been raised up in the Jewish faith, and they have come to know who Jesus is, and they can see the connect points between what they had done in their lives previously and then what Jesus fulfilled. And then you have those folks like us, which, spoiler alert, I don't think anybody in this room would be considered a Jewish Christian. We would all be considered to be part of that Gentile Christian crowd, which means we come from a place that we don't know the old traditions, we don't know the old stories, and we have our own experiences, and we may come even from situations that are vastly different than what the Jewish understanding of who God is. But yet, in Paul's writing, he's always wanting to make sure that the Gentile Christians know, as well as the Jewish Christians, that just as when I was sharing this morning with the children about the various different parts of the body, we have to know and understand that there is a great diversity in the body of Christ, and that each and every person within that body has a task, has a gift, has a purpose, has something that they offer the community at large. And the great sin that I think Paul is pushing back against in all of his letters to the Christians is when one group of Christians says to another group of Christians, "You have no place here." That seems to be what Paul is pushing back against. He's wanting his Jewish Christian brothers and sisters to open up their hearts, to know that the mystery of Jesus Christ and the work of Jesus Christ, it is much bigger than what you first and previously understood it to be. And he's calling out also to the Gentile Christians to say, don't look hatefully and ugly at these Jewish Christians. Don't look at them and think that they're just a bunch of traditionalists who have a bunch of these ceremonies, and then discount them for all of that. But instead, that there is this place where we gather together as the people of God to grow together, so that we might be able to enter back into the world and actually respond to God in the way in which God has called us to respond to Him, which is faithful. Every time God encounters someone in the scriptures, there's a decision that individual has to make. Faithfulness is that decision that we make to where we have to decide for ourselves, can we trust God? Can we trust God enough to obey Him? Can we trust God enough to do what He tells us to do? And then if we trust Him and do those things, then certainly there's going to be this transaction that takes place. When Jesus tells us that we should forgive our enemies and we're to love those who are difficult to love, it is not an easy thing to do, but it is certainly something that if we're going to trust God, we're going to say, hey, If I just do what Jesus says to do, there's going to be an appropriate response from him. A response that will help us grow in our faith as well as in our reach. And I think as Paul is talking to these Ephesians, he is wanting them to know and understand that regardless of where we come from, be it within the fold, and I think we can sit and look at this from the perspective of if you have always been involved in the church, there are things that you're going to be able to identify with when Paul is talking about Jewish Christians. There are traditions that we have if we've been raised in the church. There are understandings that we may have about the things that we do in church. When we gather here on Sunday mornings, we kind of take it for granted, or at least I do when I'm putting together worship services here, that we all know and understand why we affirm our faith, why we spend time to confess our sin, why we spend time to hear an assurance of pardon, about why we sing the songs the way that we sing. We can kind of take all of that for granted. But we also have to know that there are folks who enter into the doors of the church who don't have that foundation. They don't have that understanding of why we do what we do. See, that only comes from growth. It comes from growth within the experience and within the realization of that the things that we do in worship aren't just done so that we can say, hey, I've done that for the week, so I can just move on and do something else. But the things that we are doing within church are actually sowing seeds into our life. So that when we enter out into the world and when we have questions before us, we know where we can find answers to those questions. Jesus Christ, as Paul says in Ephesians, is that cornerstone upon which we encounter everything in life. And when we look at Jesus, we see someone who is ultimately torn down, as Paul says, the walls of hostility. We're about to enter in, and we're already there, but we're certainly about to enter into the heat of an election season, which that is the one word that I would say is going to be happening to us. Hostility, where we gather together as a nation and we try to think about what our problems are and what are the solutions. And then we end up with two, which confuses me, a nation of 350 million or so people that we just always seem to pick the same two to argue about that they're the ones that were going to lead us, but nevertheless, we'll all find out which one is going to lead us. And we all know that not everybody's going to agree on that. Which then brings up all of this hostility. Being a person of faith, being people of faith, we should be able to kind of move above the fray of those hostilities and be reminded of who is actually the cornerstone and who we're actually living for. And you see, that's where that growth comes from. It's us knowing that there's the right way to do things and then striving after that way. Not about us continually trying to build up walls of hostility. Not us trying to build up this law of commandments and saying people have to follow this, this, and that. But it's us understanding the greater good of what God has called us into, which is his promise. When we keep the main thing in our lives, and when we begin to grow in that, it's when we ponder and meditate upon the why are we going through this. Not out of a victim mindset, but more in a planning mindset. Each and every one of us enter into different worlds when we leave the church. We all have our circles of influence. We all have our circles of relationships. We all have friends and family that are different. And when we are concerned about how do we grow, I think the question comes to our mind, how do we, when we encounter these situations, how do we, when we encounter the people that God has placed around us, how are we able to communicate to them the wonderful richness of the gospel of Jesus? How are we able to tell our friends and family members and our neighbors about what God has done for us? How are we able to look into the illnesses that we have all suffered from and be able to give testimony to the goodness of God through that? How are we able to go through those times in our lives where we're very much disappointed and hurt? And how do we find Jesus there and receive consolation from him? And then how do we declare that to those around us? See, when we keep the main thing related to our growth in Jesus Christ, we're always looking to Jesus. You all know that about 12 years ago, I found myself in the emergency room at Brookwood Hospital, where I spent about a week there battling pneumonia. And then had to spend about another month sitting at home recovering from that pneumonia. One of the things that I realized when I was coherent and lucid in thought in my hospital stay, one of the things that God impressed upon me when I was there was that even though these people are caring for me, these doctors, these nurses, my family members, even though they were caring for me, there was something that I could do to care for them as well. So I made it a point whenever I, again, was lucid and thought, could think, was be able to encourage doctors and nurses in what they were doing. I didn't know if the doctors and nurses themselves knew who Jesus was. I don't know what their religious backgrounds were. I don't know any of that stuff. And I really didn't care at that point. The only thing I cared about was what I knew to be true. And what I knew to be true was that God has blessed many people in our world with many different gifts and talents and intelligences and skills that are going to better the world around us. God's given us that common grace. And so my task, when I could think about it, was to try to encourage doctors and nurses and make sure that they knew that whether they realized it or not, that God had blessed them where they were. And that I was grateful for what their work was doing for me. And I was grateful for how God was at work through their hands and through their decisions and through their treatments. Instead of laying in that bed with the poor me's, I made a decision to say, hey, I'm going to try to encourage someone with the gospel. I think that is one step in how we grow in our faith. Being able to see beyond the immediate, to see what God is doing. And know that whatever the result of what I was going through, and I know that there were situations where my family, where Cindy herself was worried. Am I going to be a widow? Am I going to be that poor old lady in the shoe with all these kids and don't have anybody to help take care? Looking beyond that immediate to see that there is a deeper and greater purpose to what is going on in the world around us. That's how Jesus encourages his disciples and his people to grow. The last thought I want to give us today as we consider this idea of growth is just Jesus in and of itself, in and of himself, how he called his disciples and who these disciples were. I know I've shared here before, prior, but allow me to share again. When a rabbi would go and pick his disciples, he would go out there and try to find people who he saw in them a little bit of himself. So the rabbi might go up and talk to a young man and say, hey, well, tell me these thoughts about God. What do you think about this with God? And if that person says something that resonated with that rabbi might say, hey, you sound a little bit like I did when I was your age. I can work with you. Think about it kind of like a draft, right? When you think about any kind of sports draft in the world, teams are looking for players that are going to kind of fit into their systems that we have. So when rabbis would go out and they would pick disciples, they would pick the biggest and the brightest, those who were smart, those who knew exactly what he was doing. How did Jesus pick disciples? Did he go and find the smartest, the greatest, the most impressive? Nope. He went down by the seaside and found these fishermen who had been through the process. They'd gone to school. They couldn't cut it. These were guys that other rabbis had passed over. And so they're out manning the family business, fishing, doing other things. Jesus goes out there and he calls them to be his disciples. And he doesn't just stop there at the seaside. He goes and finds other people, people that have been kind of pushed out to society. There's that tax collector that Jesus calls to be a disciple. Nobody liked that tax collector. But Jesus calls him to be a disciple. Then you got that one fellow, that poor Jews, who Jesus calls him. And we know that Jesus knew all of the hearts of men, and he knew exactly what was going. He knew exactly who Judas was and what Judas was going to end up doing to him. But nevertheless, what does Jesus do? He calls him. And for 3 years, Judas is there with him as a disciple. And I don't know how Jesus hopes. I don't know how you hope for things to change, especially if you've got an understanding of how things are going to end up. Jesus still worked in and through Judas throughout his ministry. And we see these disciples in the Gospels, they grow. These disciples who, at the beginning, don't know what to do, but at the end of Jesus' life and when he is resurrected from the grave, we see these same disciples seem to take on new life. Peter, a guy that just seems to be trying to impress Jesus and impress others with his sense of loyalty and dedication, becomes someone who preaches the gospel powerfully, yet humbly. You see other disciples who do the same thing, and you have to ask a question, and I've asked that question, are these the same guys? Is this Peter that writes 1st and 2nd Peter the same Peter that Jesus calls Satan? Get behind me, Satan. Is this the same Peter that denies Jesus in the courtyard of Caiaphas? And the answer to that question is yes. It's the same guy. What was it that changed between that early moment and that later moment in his life? But his growth, his understanding. Most importantly, understanding who Jesus is and understanding who he is in light of Jesus. Friends, as we grow in Christ, if we want to grow as a church, if we want to grow in our influence and in our commitment to our community, we have to first and foremost be focused upon Jesus. And then secondly, we have to understand ourselves in light of who Jesus is. That is what will unlock those places in our life where we're trying to figure out what it is we're supposed to do. What am I supposed to do in this day and time? Many of us will say, I don't know. I don't know what it is I can do. What Jesus tells us is, what Paul tells us to do, is to focus upon him. To focus upon him, to focus upon his word, and to trust him enough to follow that word. May we know and understand that word. May we, even in times when we don't know where we're to turn, be able to look to Jesus to see exactly His way, His truth, and His life. That will then lead us into those places in the world where we're able to share that good news with others and invite them on the journey with us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. That is printed in your worship guide, and please remember all of our brothers and sisters that are listed there. We want to continue to pray for Ann and Greta and Linda and Miss Joyce and Tom as they all recover from their illnesses and surgeries. We also want to remember Miss Max in our prayers. She had to go back to the hospital on Friday, and the doctors have been giving her some antibiotics and trying to help her get well. So just remember Max in your prayers this day as she receives that treatment and is hopefully going to be able to recover and be able to return home. We also want to pray for all of our caregivers, all of those who are helping take care of our brothers and sisters who are going through their times of difficulty. And then also remember that next Sunday, will be the beginning of the 193rd General Assembly of the Cumberland Presbyterian Church, which will be meeting in Evansville, Indiana this year. Pray for all of the commissioners who are going to be traveling up there, pray for their safety, and then also pray for the work of the church as our leaders make decisions and do the work of the church there. Will you join me as we now go to the Lord in a time of prayer? Mighty God, we thank you for this day and for all that you do for us. We thank you for how you care for us in our times of need. How, Lord, you rejoice with us in our times of celebration. And we ask you, Lord God, that as we continue to look at our lives and live our lives, that, Lord, that we would be faithful in our responses to you. That, God, that we would see that you have great purpose for all of us, to bring glory to your name wherever it is that we are, and to serve you around the people that you have placed us. God, as we have lifted up to you names aloud this morning of our brothers and sisters who are in need of prayer, we pray that you would be with all of those who are upon our hearts and upon our minds. That, Lord God, that you would give each of our loved ones comfort and grace and healing and peace. Lord, we thank you for those that you have blessed us with, those who do care for us in our times of need. And I ask you, Lord, that you would renew their strength as they continue to serve you by serving one another. And that, Lord God, that you would be with our church as a whole, the Homewood Church, as well as the entire Cumberland Presbyterian Church. As we encounter and navigate the landscapes of our day and time, help us, Lord, to respond faithfully and obediently to what you have called us to, so that, Lord God, we might lift your name up, and that, Lord God, we might be able to declare it to everyone that we meet. Lord, we do love you, we thank you, and we ask all of this in the name of Jesus, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let us now worship God with the giving of tithes and to better your kingdom here on earth. And Father God, be glorified in our in our lives as we serve you. For we ask this in the name of Jesus and for his sake. Amen. Friends, I invite you to join us as we conclude in worship with the singing of hymn number 122, verses 1 and 2 of Glorious is Thy Name. Friends, go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.